morning, everyone, and welcome to Central Christian Church, our online service today. Hope you're doing well on this Sunday morning. We're going to start out with, Oh, Happy Day. Oh, happy day. Oh, happy day. When wash my sins away. Oh, happy day. Well, he taught me how to watch, fight and pray, fight and pray, and live rejoicing every day. Every day, oh, happy day, oh, happy day, when Jesus washed, when he washed, when Jesus washed, washed my sins away, oh, happy day, well, he taught me to watch, fight and pray, fight and pray, and live rejoicing every day, every day. Oh, happy day when Jesus washed, when he washed, when Jesus washed, he washed my sins away. Oh, happy day. Oh, happy day. It's a happy day. Oh. All right, this next song is I Saw the Light. I wandered so aimless, I filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. And Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Just like a blind man, I wandered alone. Worries and fears I claimed for my own. And like a blind man who God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I was a fool to have wandered astray, but straight is the gate and narrow the way. Now I have traded the wrong for the right. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light. I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Your love is amazing. Your love is amazing. Steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain from beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery. How you gently lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. Hallelujah. Your love makes me sing, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Your love is surprising, I can feel it rising. All the joy that's growing inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. And I can feel this God song rising up in me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain from beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. Sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. And hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Your love makes me sing. Yeah, you make me sing. Your love makes me sing.
All right, good morning. Thank you, Russ. And thank you all for joining us today. It is good to feel your presence out there. We can see as you check in on Facebook, those folks who are watching from all around. And we are grateful to have you with us. Our scripture lesson this morning comes to us from the 16th chapter of the Old Testament book of the Exodus. The Israelites have just entered into the wilderness. Here is the word of God. The whole company of Israel complained against Moses and Aaron there in the wilderness. The Israelites said, "Why didn't God let us die in comfort in Egypt, where we had lamb stew and all the bread we could eat? You've brought us out into this wilderness to starve us to death, the whole company of Israel." God said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread down from the skies for you. The people will go out and they will gather each day's ration. I'm going to test them to see if they'll live according to my teaching or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they have gathered, it will turn out to be twice as much as their daily ration." Moses and Aaron told the people of Israel, "This evening, you will know that it is God who brought you out of Egypt, and in the morning you will see the glory of the Lord. Yes, he's listened to your complaints against him. So you haven't been complaining against us, you know, but against God." Moses said, "Since it will be God who gives you meat for your meal in the evening and your fill of bread in the morning, it's God who will have listened to your complaints against him. Who are we in all of this? You haven't been complaining to us. You've been complaining to God." Moses instructed Aaron, "Tell the whole company of Israel, come near to God. He's heard your complaints." Then Aaron gave out the instructions to the whole company of Israel, and they turned to face the wilderness. And there it was, the glory of God visible in the cloud. God spoke to Moses, "I've listened to the complaints of the Israelites. Now tell them, at dusk you will eat meat, and at dawn you'll have your fill of bread, and you'll realize that I am God, your God, That evening, quail flew in and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew all over the camp. When the layer of dew had lifted, there on the wilderness ground was a fine, flaky something, fine as frost on the ground. And the Israelites took one look, and they said to one another, "Manhu?" meaning, "What is it?" And they had no idea what it was. So Moses told them, "It's the bread God has given you to eat." May God add his blessings to our hearing and reading of the Holy Word. With so many people curtailed now by the current corona pandemic, these folks are increasingly turning to social media to cure the boredom. And one of the common things you see for people to quiz each other are lists of questions. Did you know your spouse in high school? What was your fashion? Do you still talk to your prom date? What did you drive? And so on. Now, I suppose it's kind of a guy thing, but I'm always interested in that question, what did you drive? Not so much what my fashion was, because it wasn't, or anybody's for that matter, but men generally remember every car they've ever owned. And I like thinking back on my first car. Well, it was half mine. I owned it with my brother, Daryl. If you want an exercise in patience, try owning a vehicle with your sibling. Daryl was a saint, at least then. And it wasn't exactly a car. It was a 1965 International Harvester Scout, four-wheel drive. And it was ugly. I mean, it was as ugly a vehicle as ever existed. We named it Torpo because, as Daryl so eloquently pointed out, it just sort of looks like a torpo, whatever that is. And it might have been blue once, but by the time that we owned it, it could best be described as two-toned, oxidation and rust. But it had all the amenities that it needed to get us from point A to point B. Had a steering wheel, had four tires, had kind of a racy little stick shift on the floor, and a radio, though the antenna turned out to be a piece of copper wire. But it was functional. Now our cars, both Daryl's and mine, have over the years gotten fancier. BMWs and Cadillacs and Corvettes and Datsun 280 ZXs with their heated leather seats and cruise control and CD players and Bluetooth equipped, but what they haven't gotten is any more functional. They still have steering wheels and four tires, and they take us from point A to point B. But people are like that, really, aren't they? A Timex watch keeps just as good a time as a Rolex or a Tag Heuer. But we still want the upgrade. A JCPenney shirt is every bit as comfortable as a Tommy Hilfiger. But we still want the upgrade. It seems like we never have enough. And no matter how much we do have, it seems like we can always find something to complain about. We are like the Israelites. Think about it. Now, Moses had no sooner gotten the Israelites packed into the Oldsmobile Vista Cruiser and hit the outskirts of Goshen when the complaining started. "Are we there yet? I need to go to the bathroom. Will you change the radio station? How much further? I'm hungry." The people of Israel murmured. And though I find it oddly fun to say murmured, I know from experience it was exasperating for Moses to listen to it. Having been a pastor now for 40 years next month, I am worn out from murmuring. And I suspect that I hear even more of it than Moses, because now we have email and smartphones and Twitter and Facebook and Instagram and more expanding venues for murmuring. And the Israelites, they weren't just belly aching. That's as fun to say as murmuring. They weren't just belly aching, it was downright doubt. They complained to Moses, but Moses pointed out to them just as surely that they are questioning God. They are rejecting God. And I guess what really annoys me about Exodus 16 is God's response. The complaining surges. Why didn't God let us die in comfort in Egypt? Really? Really? Where we had lamb stew and all the bread we could eat. Seriously? On the contrary, in Egypt, they had to make bricks without straw, which is difficult, every day, all day. And they had to scrounge a living as best they could. And they seldom had any meat to eat. But sometimes our memories of the good old days are just not that sharp. And so they complained, "You have brought us out in the wilderness to starve us to death." Really? Really, Israel? And then the stunner. In verse 4, God said to Moses, "I am going to rain, and I find myself hoping that the next word will be fire or lightning or big boulders, anything to quiet these murmurers, these bellyachers." But oh no, 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 no. The Lord said, "I am going to rain bread down from the skies for you." What? Wait a minute. Bread? Complainers should get discipline, not bread. I guess this is another one of those bizarre stories of grace, like Jesus' story of the workers in the vineyard who came late in the day and yet received the same pay as those who had been there all day. Or the young son who packed up his clothes and his toothbrush and his inheritance and squandered it all, only to be welcomed home with a party thrown in his honor. Bread for miserable sinners, lousy complainers, bellyachers. And I guess as one who has complained about the complainers, God has rained some bread on me as well. See, God sees us in our trouble and provides, rains bread down on us. Verse 7 says, "In the morning you will see the glory of God, and he's listened to your complaints." Isn't that the glory of the Lord? That the Lord hears our complaints and rains bread on us instead of fire or lightning or boulders. But then comes the test. The people were to go out and gather only enough for one day's ration. No more. Now maybe you hear in that test the echoes of another who said some 1,600 years later, "Give us this day our daily bread." For surely this is what Jesus has in mind, challenging each of us to trust the Lord for our daily needs. That's the test. Will they gather only enough for the day? And that's the test for us as well. Because we really like to have more than enough. We like to have a cushion, something prepared for a rainy day. You remember in March when we went into lockdown and you couldn't find a square of toilet paper anywhere. People would spend an entire day going from store to store to store to try and find that rare, elusive pack of toilet paper. One mention of a shortage, and people went berserk. Some people thought, bought enough for the rest of their lives, I think, because, well, who knows how long an apocalypse is going to last. Others were hoping, I suppose, for a monetary windfall by reselling that precious paper at exorbitant prices. But this is how we are. We need enough, but we want more than enough. At the end of the day, it is a little bit of bread that saves us. On the holy day of rest, I stand in line, sometimes literally and sometimes figuratively, with all the other murmurers and complainers and bellyachers, and receive a little bit of bread. I remember what Jesus said when he gave the chunks of bread to the hungry crowd by the sea. The bread I give you for the life of the world is my body, and it is enough. Enough for today, and I am filled with the body of Christ, with joy and with grace. And so all of you with ears to hear, please let them hear. We go now into our time of prayer, time to share the thoughts and the concerns that are upon our hearts. If you have a prayer request, I invite you to go ahead and send that to me via Facebook. First names only, please, as we try to maintain the integrity and the privacy of folks, since this is broadcast everywhere. So please send those names as we sing our prayer hymn today, Give Me Faith.
Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good, your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life.
We go into our time of prayer this morning. We have had a couple of requests. One for to remember Uncle Don, and we do want to keep that name in our hearts. And one that I have permission to share with you, that I do want to tell. It turns out that Donna Welch, her cancer has returned. It's in stage four. She is not going to have anything done. She is going to be just at home. So we do want to remember Donna and the Welch family and the church family as we surround her in prayer. And you may know of others that we did not mention out loud. Please hold them in your hearts and minds. Let us take a few moments in silence, and then we will pray together. Let us bow. Draw near to us, Holy One, and in your graciousness, grant us your peace, your grace, and your love. We live in amazing times, and we are grateful that, like the Israelites of old, you are there to lead us through, if we will but trust. Trust is hard for us, for there have been times when we have been let down, and there have been times when we have let others down. And so we find it difficult, but not impossible. So as you draw near to us in strength and in spirit, may we feel that comforting presence. You have heard those that we have listed to you, for Kim and Peter, Uncle Don and Donna. Remember us in our country, at the death of Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg. We pray that you will help us through this wilderness. So now, dear Lord, as you have surrounded us with your love, as you have inspired us with your spirit, we join together in the prayer that you taught us to say. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive others. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We go into our time of communion, of sharing about the table. And as we share together our communion hymn today, Table of Love, I invite you to take a moment and go to your pantry, your refrigerator, your kitchen, and pick out something good to eat and something good to drink. We will share together in our Feast of Love. Okay, Russ.
Here we are, you and me. I wonder if we're supposed to be here at this table. Draw me in as I am. I hope that you will understand as I come. I was tired, I am worn, I am broken, I am torn, so I come to this table. Let your peace fill my soul, cleanse my heart and make me whole, here at this table. I've come here to lay it all down. You've come to lift me up. And now we're forever bound by this bread, by this cup. Since we all have gathered round here at this table, I was blind, now I see all the ways you welcome me here. I've come here to lay it all down. You've come to lift me up. And now we're forever bound by this bread, by this cup. Here at this table of love.
Thank you, Russ. We are at the table of love. We are at that time where Jesus takes the bread and he breaks it and he gives it to his followers. The body of Christ. As God provided bread in the wilderness, as Jesus provided bread for those who followed him on the mountainside, for those who took the bread at the table. Bread is the stuff of life, and Jesus gives it to us. So we gather around this table. Separate though we are, I do remind you that we are united in spirit. And I do want to take just a moment for you to bring to mind some of those who you wish were sitting at the table with you now. Bring those people bring those names, bring those faces to mind. And with that crowd of people that are now with you, I invite you to raise a plate of something. I ask you to raise your cup of what it is you are drinking. And let us bless it together by repeating after me there at home. Holy Comforter, we gather in your name, invited by Jesus, bound together with your Spirit, in union with each other. Feed our bodies and our spirits with your comforting presence, so that we might be your comfort to others. Bless this bread and break open our hearts. Bless this drink and pour out your love. In Christ's name and for his sake, amen. And as you eat and drink what you have prepared, imagine again what extravagant love looks like. The friends, the family that share the table with you in spirit. And now may you shelter not only in place, but may you shelter in peace. The Spirit of Christ go with you. I invite you to share now in our closing blessing. The common has been made holy. The body has been remembered. Reconciliation has been represented. The world is waiting. Go in peace, and in all that you do, do it for the love and by the Spirit of Jesus, who is Lord. Amen. God be with you.
God be with you till we meet again. Loving counsels guide and hold you. With a shepherd's care for you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet. God be with you till we meet again. Unseen wings protecting hide you. Daily manna still provide you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet, till we meet, till we meet at Jesus' feet. God be with you till we meet again. When life's perils thick confound you, put unfailing arms around you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet, till we meet, till we meet at Jesus' feet. God. God be with you till we meet again.
And all God's children say amen.